Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. Just wait, just wait. Hey guys, it's the Wrestling Mayhem Show. Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on Twitter here at Mayhem Studio in Pittsburgh, PA, ready to talk pro wrestling with you guys. And with me, I got an all-star crew here this week. Of course, let's go around the horn to Bobby FG Town in Johnstown, PA.
Hi, everyone. I just want to say, I'm sorry for the audio listeners, but look what I found in the store.
Ooh.
I see Ecto Cooler, $1.99. I feel like a small child with these in my hands in the 80s.
Awesome.
And it's basically orange lava burst, but I don't care. It's green.
Is Slimer on the front of that?
No, it's slime over an orange.
That's fine. Yeah. Also with us from San Antonio, Texas, he's the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling, Eamon Payton. I called you Patron again. Eamon 2, please, on the Twitter.
Sorg, it's like you don't even know me.
I don't even know you, man.
It's not like we've been doing podcasts for how many years?
Yep, pretty much. Also with us is the Riz, the E-Riz on the Twitters.
Hi.
Riz Plays Games.
Hi.
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 That's what you got? Okay.
Hi.
And
Hi,
on the couch, he is back on the show. It's been a while. He was on the list for a while, but he's back on the casting couch. It's Hard Ass Hooven at Daniel Hooven on the Twitter. he's the photographer, of course, the fantastic photographer of International Wrestling Cartel here in Pittsburgh.
What's up, Sorg?
What's up?
It's good to be back.
Hanging
on
out
on your casting couch.
Yes.
I'm excited for this.
We're gonna catch up with you and all things Ryback and NXT. And of course, stay tuned. The final round of our WMS draft is coming up. Who is left? We're going to scrape the bottom of the barrel of that list and line up the rest of our Raw SmackDown lineups, as well as the big question and what you guys learned in wrestling. But first, please go check out our website, WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Sign up for the show. Check out some articles, including inexplicably just a Independence Day article that Matt Carlin's decided to write last week on our wrestling blog. Because I
no
gave
spoilers.
Him a login.
No
spoilers.
Not?
I don't think it's about spoilers, but it has nothing to do with wrestling. But then he did have a great one. I see he matched it up with the great one about Dean Ambrose becoming WWE champion. So we're cool there. But sign up for that kind of stuff. Also, check out ProWrestlingTees.com/WMS. Big sale going on right now. 20% off and use the code America to get 20% off here through the holiday. Go get your WMS merch and support the show and support other friends of the show while you're at it too. You can also join us here live at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com every Tuesday about 8 p.m. Eastern or so. We go for about 3 or 4 hours just talking wrestling in a quasi-organized manner for podcasting. And you can also drop us a line. The email address is...
Good times.
So excitable, guys. Thanks, I think.
Of course,
good times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com at 412-206-WMS0. Also, thanks to our Patreon supporters. You can do that as well over at patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow. Our good friends of the show, including longtime TheWrestlingRevolution.com, Tonio Garza, a part of that, as well as Bo Diggity.
Woo!
Wow.
Everybody's hot and worn out, apparently, from our previous pre-show conversations, as well as the Matt and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment. Alex Cars of Power to the Smarks and Power to the Marks. I'm sorry. Jeez.
No, you got it right the first time.
No, I did get it right the first time. Jeez. And Ed Burke, of course. You guys can support the show at patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow. All right, let's get into the show. Hi, Dan.
Hey, what's up?
Hi, Dan. Welcome back. So no, we were having some discussions, and it feels like, you know, do we really want to talk about Roman Reigns? He's not even in the studio. Like, he's not even in the studio anymore. If you saw the pictures, we kicked him out. WMS wellness policy is in effect, and of course WWE is handling that as well. I guess we should talk about it for a moment, but
you should get him a McGruff the Crime Dog thing and block his entrance into the studio.
Yeah, exactly. You know, he's just not allowed, and we're very disappointed in him and his cardboard cutout. So we're taking it out on his cardboard cutout. So
at least you're doing it on a nice day out here in Pittsburgh, so.
Yeah, for the moment.
I mean, like, if it rains, are you going to bring Roman back in?
Nope.
It's only happy when it rains.
30 days is 30 days.
30 days is 30 days. He needs to find his way. He needs to find his way throughout town here in the next 30 days.
He's going to take a duck boat everywhere.
He's going to take a duck boat everywhere. He's going to take an Uber everywhere. He's going to show up at Permane's. He's going to make appearances. That's what he's going to do with this time.
Oh, my God, Anthrocon.
He's going to be at Anthrocon.
He's going to be flat. He's going to be our flat Robbie, right? Whatever, Stanley.
I don't know. I don't know. But either way, do we even know what happened? Has it been revealed?
We still don't know.
We still don't know. This always comes out.
Drugs.
How?
Poppy seed muffins.
They're protecting the hell out of him on this one.
They never really reveal what it is.
No, but he always comes out, doesn't it?
Eventually, but like it's. Well, kind of. We don't really know a lot of. We only know like the Adam Rose one because he like was like I had a doctor's note or whatever. But like,
yeah.
Other than that, like they don't really say always what it is.
Poppy seed muffins.
Those poppy seed muffins. Well, either way, we'll see what happens with that. But I do want to check with Hooven. We know that you're a fan of the Ryback.
Yes, he is the most underutilized superstar of the past 5 years,
and even less so in recent months due to his issues. So you had some interesting news you heard about with him.
Yeah, I heard a rumor that Ryback will be his contract runs up this summer.
Yeah,
and because the powers to be don't want to sign what could be the true superstar of this generation, the next John Cena, the next cash cow, and Ryback. He may be he's not, they're just going to keep him under contract and release him, and he will be taking probably independent dates. I'm sure he'll do movies, probably get an offer to become the Ryborg with TNA Impact. He probably will get offers from Ring of Honor and New Japan, but he may be available for independent bookings as Ryan Reeves. And I think, you know, good for him. I hope he does what Albert did and goes somewhere and proves it to WWE how badly they dropped the ball. Hopefully he doesn't come back as a pretend Asian. But
tire mark over his face.
But so Ryback might be a free agent soon. It's a shame because there's money in Ryback and they missed the ball with him.
Mm-hmm. So what do you
Okay, Hooven, I got a question for Hooven. If he shows up at IWC
mm-hmm.
and you're there,
mm-hmm.
how erect are you gonna be?
Well, I've never marked out before. I don't believe I would. I would shake his hand politely, and then probably watch him eat a lot of food, and then take some pictures.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't want to be the guy that freaks out over somebody coming in back.
Just for your private, collection.
Just for my private collection. I think that he would be a good influence on the locker room, and I feel like I like to see him eat food. I like to see how much he really eats.
Okay.
All right.
Man, that was my one question.
I want to know his thoughts on D-Rex.
We're getting a little inside baseball here, but he's one of those guys like you know, obviously Cody Rhodes is popping up with his list and everything. And it looks like we're getting some Cody Rhodes dream matches coming up here. I'm curious, like what would Ryback's post WWE career B.
I think it would be interesting because Ryback is not a Jesus to the marks, such as Cody Rhodes and Damian Sandow.
Right, right.
Both who I like very much. I think they were both underutilized, and I think if SmackDown and Raw were separate entities, both of them would have had a title run with SmackDown. I feel like he's one of those wrestlers that people won't admit that they would pay to go see, but they'd go see it.
Mm-hmm.
I think he would find a home. I would hope he would find a home somewhere in a larger indie place. You know, they have Pro Wrestling Guerrilla out there in Los Angeles. I think he lives in Las Vegas. So I think the reaction would be good. I mean, I think it would be good because I feel like he loves wrestling. People shit on Ryback all the time, all the marks about how he can't work and all this stuff. But the guy's dedicated his entire life to becoming a professional wrestler. So I feel like, you know, he would like to do their shows. I think he would have fun. And I think fans would appreciate him more because, you know, once again, I mean, here's a guy that has, since he was a kid, wanted to be a pro wrestler and he achieved his dream. And I think people forget that about him.
I think the biggest thing, I think the biggest thing for him would be Japan. I think he'd be great there. I mean, look at what Tensai did there, right? To really mm-hmm. kind of gain his value, right? That he brought back and he's in a role now, right?
I was going to say, not even Tensai. Look at Gallows.
Yeah, yeah.
It was Festus.
I mean, you don't see a lot of big guys really do well on the indies unless there's somebody that, you know, like a Kevin Nash or somebody mm-hmm. like that, right? Because it's kind of a little guy's land for the most part. And I feel like he gets booked the most shows, and nothing against to any of the crews that we work with or anything, but I think, you know, any indie that I can think of getting booked in the area, everybody's going to be half his size, either in height or width at that point, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And unless you're throwing them against, like, I think a dream match would be like Cage. Ray Rowe or something, right? What's that?
Cage.
Cage, yeah, a Cage kind of matchup, or even with maybe a Johnny Mundo or something like that. I guess the standing answer, let's see what Lucha Underground could do with him.
You also, well, because I thought about this as well, because Hooven brings up like the point of like leaving money on the table and stuff like that. How much money and how much buzz would there be if somebody promoted a CM Punk Ryback UFC match?
Oh, wow.
I think CM Punk will get injured again since he gets injured every time he's supposed to fight.
If he ever fights, let me clarify that.
He's already fighting Cody Rhodes.
I don't know. I mean, I think there'd be money. I think there's money in every former WWE superstar, to be honest. I mean, I mean, you look at a lot of guys, and God bless them, that are still making a living on the indies. You know, you're a WWE lower mid-carder, and Ryback, he was a main eventer for about the 3 or 4 month period in the program of CM Punk.
He was.
There's money to be made there for them on the indie scene, and rightfully so. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, once you have that former WWE superstar label on you, you know, you can make a good living on the indies, and rightfully so.
And that opens up doors for opportunities to do something different, like Johnny Mundo's done with between the acting and other feds. Mm-hmm. I mean, your work is out there. And if somebody out there says, okay, we could take that and do this with it, which I think is what we're seeing a lot with Lucha or Japan or something like that to really good effect. So I think he seems like a guy that has, you know, I would question a little bit how he came out against WWE's booking and tactics and pay as an employer is questionable, because you got to think anywhere you work. If you went and wrote a blog about how much the pay is not fair, see how long you last too in the long run. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's just jobs. You know, that's not wrestling. Steve that's jobs. Not anything else. So, other than that, like, he seems like a guy with a positive attitude for the most part, right? And a good look and everything, and he can go as a big guy in the ring. He's not going to be AJ Styles.
That Kalisto match, which is so wrong on so many levels, he had to lose to Kalisto twice. I mean, I'm 5'6", and I should never compete with somebody that's 6 foot if I was ever to do anything. It's just not believable. But the WrestleMania pre-show match with Kalisto and Ryback was spectacular, and they played the big man, small man. The outcome was wrong, in my opinion. I don't think Kalisto should ever go over somebody 3 times his size, but it was a good match. Ryback can go. I mean, he's underrated. He's just, you know, he's the guy that the new millennial fans see and go, oh, we don't like that. You know, he has big muscles. He can't wrestle.
Mm-hmm.
That's just, you know, most of their attitude, unfortunately, when he can actually really go. And I feel like he gets disrespected a lot. I mean, really anybody in the WWE can work or they wouldn't be there. And I think people forget that.
Mm-hmm.
He worked his role. His role was to be a big guy.
They did have a good match at WrestleMania.
It was very good. I mean, he did a second rope press slam to Kalisto, among a lot of things. Yeah, I don't know. It's a shame to see what happened to Ryback. He could have been the songbird of this generation.
Well, at least there's a lot of opportunities. Maybe we'll go to Ring of Honor and do something. All right. Well, we're going to talk a little bit more wrestling. We're going to talk about a little more wrestling, including NXT. And maybe, I don't know, maybe we'll touch base. I don't know if there's any new news of the Cruiserweight Classic. I know they did a presentation about a week ago. I had some problems finding it on Facebook, actually. And then we'll talk about that, too. But in the meantime, hey, Hooven's in here. You know how Hooven got in here. You said that this is the best post-workout feast that we have in here, Slice on Broadway.
Yeah, Slice on Broadway. Healthy.
It's
very good, though. I mean, I there's Beto's, there's some other places, but Slice on Broadway, best pizza in Pittsburgh. And when I found out they actually sponsored Sorgatron Media in the podcast, I mean, I started ordering 3 instead of 2 plates.
Awesome. Awesome. They're right here in Beachview, as he said, right along the tracks as well as on Main Street in Carnegie, PA. Or if you're downtown, swing over to PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates, and go check it out there. They've been supporting the Pittsburgh podcast with the Perfect Pepperoni Pizza for a couple of years now. And thank you so much to them. Again, some people in here on the couch, hang out with us in person as much as we can, and getting some activity here on the podcast and helping out, because a lot of you guys are swinging in dinner time here when we do things live here on Tuesday nights, and we really, really appreciate it. So shout out to them, sliceonbroadway.com, PGH_slice on the Twitter, Slice on Broadway on Facebook and Instagram. I think they're enjoying our business invention things we've been doing on Twitter lately. We had the pizza box, loot crate for pizza, that we hope that they really run with. And we've had some other fun ideas as well that we've passed along. So I hope they remember us when they're the biggest chain pizza in the world.
This month's theme is pepperoni.
I really like that they're back downtown again at PNC Park. The other place was horrible, and I wasn't allowed in there anymore, so I'm glad that I can get pizza down at the baseball games now.
There you go. Awesome. Hey, crazy things happen at those Pirate games, right? That we can talk about, of course. Also, speaking of food places, I want to give a shout-out. I was wearing it today, so I was reminded. Right here, our friends at Lucha Libre Taco Shop in San Diego. It's my home away from home in San Diego. So sporting some gear here today, so shout out to them.
They don't sponsor us.
No, that was just they're awesome, so go check them out. Tacosmackdown.com if you're interested. Our friends from the Scare House actually have checked them out too, so some shouts there. All right, there's a lot going on. Of course, NXT, we had the announcement of the dream match this happened in Japan, but we're getting the American version of it, of Nakamura. And there's Hooven's opinion of that, of course. Finn Balor.
Balor.
You can't. Damn it. Never say his name
I've
right.
been trying. You I Balor. Said it. I said Balor. It.
Three times.
I said it like 3 times in front of my wife, and I was like, did I do it right? She's like, you did it right. I'm like, great, let's tell the guy.
Since you've called him Baylor.
Balor.
Okay, Sorg, he is not a piece of farm equipment.
Damn it.
He's not a college.
Yeah. Wait until he gets to the main roster. That's his new gimmick.
An educated piece of farm equipment.
Baylor. Baylor. Baylor.
Baylor.
Baylor.
Baylor. Baylor. Balor.
Balor.
You keep on saying it wrong, Sorg.
Well, anyways, there's that happening.
Think of Valor, only with a B.
Valor. Balor. There you Balor. Go. I'm gonna,
that's
you know
the
what?
Reason the thing is over the end.
Hold on. We're going to write right here on this thing, phonetically, how to spell Finn Balor. I did it right.
Yeah.
Because
I don't
know. I heard the guy.
Finn.
Good job, Sorg.
Al as in Al Bundy.
Yes.
No, or,
yeah.
No, ma'am.
Or
since the bell
no,
fell.
No, wait, no.
Or
say that again.
Balor.
I heard since the Dow fell, the government's looking forward to a Finn bailout.
This
bailout.
Is going right here, right yeah. by where Eamon's screen is, so I remember how to say Finn Balor.
There we go.
Because it's in front of me. It's right there, Finn.
What's his opponent's name?
Shinsuke Nakamura.
Good on you.
That's
how you can get that one.
Sword.
All right, now who is the NXT women's champion?
The women's champion? Asuka.
Asuka. There we go. Close enough. Close Asuka. Enough. No, Asuka. It's not close enough.
Asuka?
It's Asuka.
Asuka.
Asuka. You said Asuka. Asuka.
See, I hear Regal say it. We do this every week. I hear Regal say it, and I just think it's his funny accent that's making it weird.
Who's the Hollywood actor from Pittsburgh that sometimes attends PWG and it's going out with Sofia Vergara?
Oh, yeah, Joe Mangiello. That one I don't even try.
That's it.
I don't even attempt that one. He's just Joe Mangiello.
Joe Mangiello.
No man. Joe
NXT.
Joe Mangiello, not an NXT.
Thank you, Joe Mangiello.
I bet Joe Mangiello is going to go to NXT.
Yep. Yes, he is.
Mangiello.
Yes, he is. Anyways, I don't know what else the segment's about at this point, other than my phonetic problems with NXT. So we had the end. We had the end. The end of the beginning. That's weird. And we're on to the next phase of whatever NXT is going to be. We also have the Cruiserweight Classic, so it's getting very busy on our Wednesday nights, apparently, coming up.
Is this going on? Who is making the best faces?
What? What's happening? I don't have all the feeds up here for you guys. You're all in the hangout together. But what do you guys think so far? I know we're only about a week or two after that last pay-per-view. But the kind of state of NXT going forward, is it going? We obviously lost a lot of people to Raw. Do we guys think it's going to? Does it still have your attention like it used to?
Yeah.
It definitely does, Bobby.
It's fine. It's fine.
It's fine.
I just want to say, Austin Aries.
Mm-hmm.
I loved the No Way Jose thing because I'm like, when's he gonna turn? When's he gonna turn? There it is! And it was the greatest thing in the world.
There was a lot of dancing to go down that road.
There was
to have him turn last week. So
it was a good bait and switch.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think everything obviously is super up in the air when it comes to like the draft and stuff like that, and when things are going to be happening there. Like, you know, right now we're not really sure. But
rumored to be at least 10 or at least 6 or 10. 6 to 10.
Anyway. Possible call-ups, yeah.
Yeah.
Which I think that could leave the roster, depending if they bring enough people back into the fold, like it could leave them in a bit of a drought possibly, but we'll have to see.
But we're also very deep into this idea of having guys that are, you know, more or less veterans like Samoa Joe, Finn Balor, and
there we go.
The sign is going to help us. There's going to be a pause while I go look for the sign, but this is going to help us. Also, props to our friends looking for a group that wrote it on the back of their sticker.
I'm going to sneak and Jake when you say Finn from now on.
I don't remember my point anywhere. Hooven, what do you think of anything? Hooven,
the established kind of guys in NXT.
Yeah, the established guys like that, or, you know, the cast-offs from Impact, which is really funny that that's kind of going that way now. But I think it'd be interesting to see where these guys are going from. Hooven, what do you think of NXT?
I'm a big NXT fan, actually. I love NXT. I just, when it first came out, you know, to be honest, I run probably a month behind and I'll catch the specials. I still say that the NXT Brooklyn match with Sasha Banks and Bayley is probably the best match in the past few years I've seen from a storytelling perspective. Mm-hmm. If I had to introduce somebody to pro wrestling, I would show them that match with the vignette because it was so good. It was the ultimate story of good beating bad after a hard fought, you know, battle. And just everything was perfect from Sasha's entrance to Bayley's entrance, where she just kind of looked like, you know, right before she started the match, she kind of looked at the ring and gave the, here we go, you know. I get it. I like when I see some veterans in there, but I also, if I was in NXT as a developmental talent, you know, I would be kind of upset. I don't see the value of Samoa Joe or James Storm. I think he went away. I don't see their value in there. Obviously, Austin Aries.
Bobby Roode now.
Bobby Roode. I love that. Bobby Roode should have been in the Federation 5 years ago. I get annoyed, not annoyed with, it's not the product. I love the product, but Nakamura. So let me talk about Nakamura. So I watched his AJ Styles match, and from whatever that show was, it was great, man. That Nakamura Styles, spectacular, like absolutely spectacular.
You talking about Wrestle Kingdom earlier
yes,
this year?
Yeah, Wrestle
yeah.
Kingdom.
Yeah.
The one everybody's freaking out about, and rightfully so.
Yeah.
So here's where I take issue, and this has nothing to do with NXT or the product or the wrestlers. It's the fans. The fans of NXT, I think, are out of control. The regulars, they want to make the show about themselves. Nakamura, when he first came out, if he would have just came out, wrestled, did his thing with Sami Zayn, I would have said it was a great, it was a good match. It wasn't great. Everybody seems to think it was the greatest match of the century.
The fans made it.
The fans made it out to be, when really, in my opinion, and this is just an opinion, everybody has one, I'm not wrong or right, I think on that pay-per-view, whatever you want to call it, the tag team match with the American Alphas beating, was it Blake and Murphy or no, the Revival?
The Revival.
Yeah, the Revival, Jesus. But they beat the Revival. I thought that was the best match of the show. I mean, really, it's the opening match, so it should be the second best one. But NXT, and if this makes sense, I love the Dave Matthews Band music, right? I love Dave Matthews Band music. They're very talented. But just like Dave Matthews Band, the fans are ruining a good product. Nakamura could have came to the ring, did more of his whole like shivering thing he does, pulled his pants down, taken a shit in the middle of the ring and rolled in it, and they would have chanted, "This is awesome."
Which it would have been.
I have to watch one more match where fans are chanting, "This is awesome," before anything happens, like what is like, that's stupid. You don't, they could go out there and do the dumbest things and the fans would be coming all over it. And I feel like the fans need to remember they're not part of the show. You know, I remember in ECW, as if you go back and watch old ECW, now I'm from Philly, I grew up with ECW. The fans were rowdy, we were loud, but we never made it about us. It was always about the wrestlers. And I feel like the NXT fans down in Florida are getting, they sometimes ruin the show for me because it gets so annoying hearing them. But I think NXT, you know, another thing, Mark Madden said this the other day, and he's completely right. If they're calling people up and Bayley's not caught up, that's a big mistake. Because her allure is being a little girl's hero. She's 27. I didn't know that. But Mark Madden said it. She only has a few more years with this gimmick left.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
before it gets weird.
Before it gets weird. But yeah, no, I love NXT. Well, I think it's a great alternative. But I think the fans are just, they ruin it sometimes. Like, you know, oh, it's so much better than WWE. WWE sucks. No, it shows how stupid some people are where the same company is selling you a alternate product and you're bashing the company that owns it when they're the ones running it.
But either way, that runs in their favor because you're still paying something.
It does because the people are idiots and think that it's actually an alternative. Just like they think Shane McMahon's actually in charge of Raw.
Right, exactly. Right. Hey, man, you have something you've been trying to say.
Well, I think, and I'm not trying to like direct blame elsewhere, but I think to me one of the main causes of it is WWE has kind of made it known that they are embracing now those like kind of reactions. They've been doing it, in my opinion, ever since that whole post-WrestleMania Raw crowd became a thing. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And they're recognizing it now as a thing. That, you know, to where crowds are expected now to, you know, chant shit.
They didn't do the wave last night.
Do the wave, stuff like that. And it's really kind of expected now. And it's kind of them being like, yeah, go ahead and do this. You know, kind of. They're basically being like, when they preface like the Mania Raw with prefacing it when JBL's on commentary, going, now guys, this is notorious where like the crowds are super, you know, crazy and special. They're having fun tonight.
Like the Bizarro World.
Yeah, well,
Bizarro World.
It used to, yeah, they used to call that. They used to say Bizarro World. Now it's they're having fun. And right. when that's the narrative you're telling, it just encourages those people to do it more. And I think if you want to talk about like an NXT degree, I don't know if you watched the Breaking Ground that they did covering that Mania Weekend takeover.
It was amazing.
But oh, that whole series was
Triple H is in the booth, like doing the like directing or whatever, and the Nakamura comes out and he says audibly, it's probably pretty good when they're chanting holy shit before they even touch. So I feel like they're also in that mentality of like they're cool with that. Like they're encouraging that.
No, I want to clarify. You know
what I mean? And I'm not trying to direct blame off of the fans because, right. It should be on them. But I think WWE has created this thing where they are kind of encouraging it and trying to nurture it more, which can cause it to go overboard, I feel, sometimes.
So let me, for context, Dan, when you watched that match – mm-hmm. Did you watch it WrestleMania weekend? Did you watch it live?
Which one?
The Nakamura match in particular.
The one with Sami Zayn?
Yeah, the first one.
I actually watched that whole event live. It was, I liked the show.
So I want to put in context, like, think this is WrestleMania weekend. This is somebody that a lot of people in that crowd know who he is and are anticipating him. So I think it's more the anticipation, holy crap, he's here, than the match that actually got turned out, right?
I guess. I mean, I guess. I was, you know, to be honest, they hyped me up. I was excited to see what this guy could do. And he came out and just, like, did, like, the big wiggle to the ring, like Norman Smiley. And everybody's, like, freaking out over this guy. And I'm like, I don't get it. Maybe it's me. I don't get it. But I was expecting, you know, I really was expecting, like, this really badass dude to come out. And then they talk about strong style, which you can say if that's real or not. I think that's a marketing gimmick people take too far.
But I think
it's like the King of Strong Style. That's
Shinsuke is one of those guys where, you know, as far as the wiggling and the entrance and everything like that, I think that was just a, oh, this is his regular entrance. Wait till he gets bigger. Kind of like Finn came in and was just Finn until we had his first big kind of main event takeover kind of thing. And we're like, oh, this is Finn, you know, and you got to see like the different side of his character. I'm curious to see what happens. Is it a takeover that we're going to have Shinsuke and Finn?
No, that's actually an episode of NXT.
Okay, that'll be interesting. I'm curious to see how that match comes out. I
wonder if they're doing that because of the draft, to be honest, because that's a match. Yeah, that's a match.
It should fall in July, yeah.
Yeah, that's a match you would save. I mean, don't get me wrong. I get that Nakamura was big overseas, and I get that, you know, people are freaking out because he's here. But I asked somebody that's a big fan. I said, what is it? And he's like, oh, man, he's dope. He's like the Japanese Michael Jackson. I said, I don't get it.
But right now it's everybody on his previous – you know, his reputation has preceded him for a lot of people.
Because Daniel, you mentioned that you'd watch the match with AJ Styles at Wrestle Kingdom.
That was great.
I think I still enjoying Nakamura's time in NXT, but it's definitely a bit of a tone down from his stuff in New Japan, because that's obviously what he has to do, because the stuff they do in New Japan, he can't do like every. You know, he can't do it like house shows.
And he can't roll into NXT on a full throttle. The Nakamura that you got to see in Japan is a Nakamura that built over time, right? So we're starting a little bit from square one here. And I think they're, you know, like Finn, there's like this reintroduction that has to the WWE fans.
Well, and to me, it's a fresh introduction. Like, I don't know Nakamura, and I really to say it kind of felt like Glacier. I saw all these hype videos, got excited. I'm like, man, like, I can't wait for him to come out.
We saw a cell phone video of him turning around with his hair in the face, saying, "I am here," in broken English,
and people freaked out over that. How pathetic is that?
Because that is the.
It's Nakamura in WWE. That's pretty much
That was just the anticipation. Different. Everybody knew it was coming. And also, the problems you're having with this crowd, and I'm going to say not the NXT crowd, like I'm going to boil this down because the ones you hear every week, the Full Sail fans. And everybody on the show is going to remember the conversations we've had for years. TNA's got to get out of Orlando. TNA's got to get out of Orlando. Yes. That crowd is killing them. Holy crap. They are so annoying. It's the same people. It's 400 people in that crowd?
Yes.
I mean, Dan, we talked about a couple weeks ago on Indie Mayhem show about how five fans made things weird at Super Indie for a match. That makes Riz grow. You know what I mean? Like, I think it's when you have that regular small crowd, they create their own, you know, they create their own vibe.
And that's I get it. Like, I mean, ECW, but like I said, it was just different. With ECW, we chanted for the wrestlers. You were
part of that crowd, right?
Yeah. But we knew that we weren't the part of the show. We weren't as important as the wrestlers in the ring because they're the athletes. They're the ones putting their lives on the line.
Yeah, let's say straw hat guy.
And but people recognize him. People recognize them, but they never once tried to chant, "We are awesome." Mm-hmm. Or shit like that. Like, they had respect for the wrestlers in the ring. Mm-hmm. Now you have clowns walk, literally clowns like Frank the Clown or Brock Lesnar guy that walk around like they're celebrities when they're really just somebody that pays a lot of money.
Also,
fuck Frank the Clown.
It's also the era where they all have a Twitter account and you actually can become a celebrity that way
Why would you want to be known as I mean, I don't understand the allure of that.
That's
other than bagging Mick Foley's daughter, I have to say he has me beat.
I
gotta
say, somebody
it paid off for Frank. You know, he's banging the doll, he's banging a hot chick. There we go.
Look, if I was like doing Noelle Foley, I would probably have a Twitter page saying I'm doing it each and every day.
I stand corrected. I agree with that.
Holy Foley.
There's a tweet that says Holy Foley every
I don't want to wear clown makeup.
No, I mean, this is, I mean, again, so we have access to social media and Twitter, right, on one hand. And these are fans of larger-than-life characters that, man, they wish they could be like, but they're...
Why don't they man up and do it?
But they're... Well, not everybody can be a wrestler, as you
Brock
know.
Brock Lesnar guy's jacked. Have you seen Brock Lesnar guy?
That doesn't mean he can be a wrestler.
Frank the Clown's a young man. He could do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure he will. Actually, I'm sure that's going to be part of season two of Holy Foley. From a storytelling and reality TV show perspective, she's going to get in the ring, mm-hmm. and he's going to follow suit, mm-hmm. and there's going to be drama. It makes sense. I mean, I'd watch it.
The next Doink the Clown.
Didn't that happened on Total Divas too, didn't it?
Eva Marie's boyfriend tried to do it, and Prince Albert made him throw up. I watch more. I love Total Divas.
That was Cameron. That was Cameron's boyfriend.
Oh, you're right. Yeah.
What was he? He was Sicilian or something?
Yeah, he was like Conan number two.
Yeah.
Nice guy.
I like how we know the boyfriend's name now. It's Vinny.
Going back to the Nakamura stuff, though, I just want to say he's different. And when was the last time a Japanese superstar came over to America in the WWE?
Hideo?
And they let him be himself.
Hideo?
Besides Hideo Itami. I'm talking like... That actually stuck around.
And Tajiri?
Hideo was hurt. I mean, he couldn't help that.
Tajiri's one, but Hideo, they changed his
name. Was Tajiri himself, though?
Yeah. I mean, he was pretty much himself.
Yeah. But yeah. Like then again, he was comic relief to.
But
okay. Well, I think a better question is.
I love Tajiri. Tajiri's one of my favorites.
I think a better question is when has a Japanese star came in and has been able to rise to a certain level?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I could see, like, especially with the brand split happening. If Nakamura gets drafted tomorrow, he could be in that heavyweight title picture.
I will put money on this. And this is something that's also kind of – it makes me sad. I was a big Tyler Breeze fan, huge Apollo Crews fan. And, you know, you think they're going to be really big and popular because of the crowd reaction they get. But when they come up with the main, it's actually interesting to see that there's still a good amount of people that don't watch NXT or know of it. It's kind of like when ECW stars came and you had the spattering of ECW, but for the large part, they remained on the mid card. Now, I hope everybody that works, I hope everybody in there succeeds. I they're all at the end of the day, they're people that are working, putting their bodies on the line and deserve, you know, respect and success in different aspects. But I don't, you know, maybe I'm wrong, could we're in a new era, but I don't see Nakamura rising above the mid card on the main roster. And I hope that Finn Balor would be a world champion because I think he's absolutely amazing. It's hard to say. I mean, you see these really great acts from NXT go up and get lost in the shuffle. I don't want to come off like an internet guy, but it's, you know, you see somebody like Tyler Breeze who has a
You're a guy that's on the internet right now, so you're allowed to.
He has a mid-card, so he should be like in the IC title picture.
But,
you know, it all takes time. I mean, we just saw, in my opinion, probably the last time I marked out was Money in the Bank. I actually texted a friend of mine during the show, and I said, Dean Ambrose is going to win Money in the Bank cash in tonight. And like, yeah, okay. And that was a moment I feel that a lot of people felt vindicated because Dean Ambrose is a guy that was never supposed to be where he is. And he worked his ass off.
He was doing death matches. He's a guy, and we've admitted on the show, he popped up in IWC, and I didn't give a crap about him.
Oh, I was a huge fan of Moxley at CZW.
I had no idea.
He was when I left Philadelphia, it was like Moxley was coming into his own down there. We all thought he was the next big thing, and everybody said, he just doesn't have the look. And now there he is. And God bless him, man. That makes me so happy because he is an indie guy that made it to the world. He's this is a horrible comparison, but from a story-wise, I mean, he's Daniel Bryan. Seth Rollins, you know, the guy.
I can even see what's like. I can see people looking at Seth Rollins on the indies and being like, that guy could succeed to some level in WWE. But I agree. I consider him more like a Bryan Danielson, where it's like a guy who like did deathmatch and like looked the way that he looked, like shouldn't have been WWE champion. But
I'm excited. Yeah. It's awesome. It's and I feel like you guys remember like a year ago when everybody was injured and Ambrose pretty much carried Raw for like 3 months.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, he can carry the show. Ratings went up.
And Seth. I would watch a lot of SmackDown and it was like, wow, this is the Seth Rollins is carrying the two flagship shows.
I mean, that Shield, that's almost, what happened. Oh, sorry.
No, I was say almost single-handedly.
I was just going to say the Shield, that's what happens when you take care of your talent and you watch out for them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, the Shield, it's kind of funny, kind of to go full circle. My boy Ryback, the only thing he'll ever be known for is a trivia question. Who did the Shield beat up when they debuted? And it's gotta be—he's a footnote into history. But I mean, look at the Shield, man. Three guys from developmental, from when it was Florida Wrestling, that are now carrying the company. Right. That's awesome, you know. And they're guys that started on the indie scene. I mean, it's great to see people like that succeed and do it together.
Was Roman an indie guy? I thought
no. He was.
He came into developmental, right?
I think, and this is just something I read. I don't know if it's true, but they wanted. I guess they see him. CM Punk had asked for, because he was going to get the Shield.
He had asked
for Seth Rollins, Dean Ambrose, and Chris Hero.
Right.
And Triple H made, in my opinion, the right move and said, no, we'll give you somebody else. Yes. And they put Roman Reigns in it, because I'm not a Hero fan.
It actually is funny. Yeah, it probably was the right move, because I feel like Hero probably would have blended in too much, like just with Rollins and Ambrose. So, like, they're too similar.
Yeah, I couldn't see him pulling that off, the ruthlessness that they were going to do with that, something like that.
And that's when fans like Roman Reigns. He really hasn't changed. It just, you know, became cool to hate Roman Reigns. I was at the Royal Rumble, 2 years ago when Pittsburgh made Roman Reigns the babyface he became, and then the next year they were just shitting on him.
Yeah.
Well, I like Roman. I feel bad. Everybody hates on him. I like Roman Reigns, dude.
I don't know what it is.
And then he fucked up.
And then there's that. Yeah.
Go yell at him right now, Sword. Where is he?
The fans.
He's outside. He's outside. Where he should be.
The fans probably made him do drugs, man. Roman Reigns, God bless him. Fans, why they got to shit on everybody like that? I like John Cena. I like Roman Reigns. Why people got to shit on them? What was the best part of Raw last year? John Cena's U.S. Open title. You know,
I hope Roman gets to that point where it's John Cena is now, where it's like you get people still chant, you know, that he sucks, obviously, but it's like he's kind of. I'm firmly enjoying the stuff he's done in the last couple of years. So
that's because he's the guy.
He's a suspended guy.
All right. On that note, guys, we'll talk a lot more about this, I'm sure, in the coming weeks, because we'll talk a lot about Roman while he's not in the room, as he's been expelled from Mayhem Studios. In the meantime, you got some awesome stuff you can check out. Speaking of the future, we've been making some pretty bold statements around this. And I know, Hooven, you didn't get a chance to check this out. You weren't there, but I had a blast editing IWC Super Indie 15. It's over at indiewrestling.us right now, digital download and DVD. Just an all-star lineup. This is a tournament over the years that has spawned people. You look at the alumni on this. You know, El Generico, the Sami Zayn now.
CM
Punk, early days with this. Christopher Daniels, AJ Styles, Sterling James Keenan, and now Corey Graves. And you look at these lists and you just say, okay, which of these guys are we going to see on our NXT and our Monday Night Raw within the next 5 years? Because it's almost inevitable at this point.
I mean, look at the lineup last year.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the lineup last year. Isn't, I believe, Trevor Lee... And what was the African American's name?
Cedric Alexander.
Yeah, he's on the Cruiserweight Classic.
Cedric Alexander.
And I will say, and I know Sorgatron can't say this because he's a businessman, but IWC is the best pro wrestling in Western Pennsylvania and the Pittsburgh area.
No, actually, I do say that.
And I think that the show itself. No, I'm unfortunately usually not able to make Super Indie because I have a conflicting annual event.
Mm-hmm.
I have to give a lot of kudos to Justin Plummer for that lineup. I mean, you know, there was actually what people don't know is, you know, there was two substitutions for that.
Yeah.
Bad Boy Joey Janelle and Zachary Wentz were injured. So he pulls in best of the best winner, Jonathan Gresham from CZW, and Gory, which from what I hear was a huge pop. But I mean, look at that poster. You have Darren De Niro, Jaylet Winner, Josh Alexander, Andrew Palace, Gory, Chris LaRusso, Jonathan Gresham, Desmond Xavier. I'm a huge Xavier fan. And Sugar Dunkerton. I mean, from all accounts, you watched the video, you edited it. But I mean, it's just, I think it's a testament to IWC and where they're going right now.
It's like this. So I'm sitting down at this thing, and I probably would have been a mess if I was there live taking care of this thing, because I was just popping. I had to stop the pop. Like, there was a point where they did some foot move, like Grisham flipped up the body of Josh Alexander right out of frame, and I almost dropped my laptop. Okay, because I was like, what just happened? You know, and kudos to the guys to Rob and Chachi for keeping up with the action. Because wow,
and Rob's sexy.
If I may, swear.
Riz, who was there?
I've been to a lot of Super Indies, and this is probably one of my favorite Super Indies I've been to. Mm-hmm. I mean, just the level, like Hooven said, the level of talent that we had going into this is amazing. And it proved in the ring that it was amazing. Mm-hmm. And if you want to buy this DVD, go to indiewrestling.us.com. Or
yeah, you're right.
I almost did .com.
You're right. No, we don't own that one. We don't own that one.
Finn Balor.
We don't have $5,000 to buy that one. Sorry. So if we could try a GoFundMe, if you buy enough copies of Super Indie, we can go buy indiewrestling.com.
How's our first GoFundMe going, Sorg?
It's not going well.
And also on that Super Indie card, I mean, not only you know that it's Super Indie, so obviously the tournament's a big draw, but I mean they also had a match, a title match that I thought was, I think, the first time they've wrestled, and to me on paper and from what I hear was spectacular. But you have Impact Wrestling star, and current IWC World Heavyweight Champion DJZ. Taking on Dylan Bostic, who debuted Reloaded about a year and a half ago, who's been on a hot streak. I mean, him and Ray Lynn, the Platinum World Tour.
Winner of last year's Super Indie.
Winner of last year's Super Indie is now in the World Heavyweight title mix. And, I mean, just that card, when I saw it on paper, I regretted missing it. But luckily, you can own it through digital download today at indiewrestling.us.
Yes, yes. And this is the first Super Indie I have missed since Super Indie 6. Probably numbers right. And I'm pissed that I missed this one. Go check it out. IndieWrestling.us. There's so many other great, great titles, including stuff with Zach Gowen, finding Zach Gowen on here, as well as the Hardcore Heroes with Gregory Iron, both showing up on American Ninja Warrior. Great showing by
that was
Zach
awesome.
There. That was great.
That was awesome.
It was so
that
great.
Was awesome. Good for him, man.
It was
awesome
to see that and his wife out there, who is also super awesome and super friendly. Great crew down there. And so go check that out. And so many other great titles and other people that are making a lot of people stop through Pittsburgh. Dalton Castle, AJ Styles, some guy named Phil, CM Punk. And hey, we're just talking about Chris Hero made a good stop through IWC. There's a best of Chris Hero there as well from, geez, matches from like 2002. Guys,
the
how about Chris Hero and Al Snow in 2004? Chris Hero and AJ Styles at Erie Explosion in 2004. Great lineups here. You know, just pump in some names and you'll be surprised. I think we do have one Dean Ambrose on here. No Tyler Black. No.
You have that Disco Inferno match, Sork?
I don't think we put the Disco Inferno versus was it Raven? I don't think we posted that just yet. IndieWrestling.us, go check it out. Sign up for the newsletter. Get updates on what's coming out, sales, and, of course, what's going on with the Wrestling Mayhem Show. We'll be right back with the big question.
This is George Rutherford, former writer for WWE SmackDown, fuck TNA, and you're listening to the Wrestling Mayhem Show.
Wrestling Mayhem Show, we are back. The crew is with us. Dan Hooven on the couch. Hey, what's your... So, Daniel Hooven on the Twitter, but what like for photography, where can people get at you?
Oh, I'm lazy. I don't have a photography.
Just get at your Twitter.
Instagram at Daniel Hooven. Most of it's inappropriate, sexist, racist stuff, or me looking nice. But there are some actual pictures on there. So Daniel Hooven everywhere. I have no creativity.
Mm-hmm. And you know exactly what you're getting into. And of course, also Bobby F. J. Town, Eamon Payton from Inspire Pro Wrestling, and The Riz. No, we're not doing that here. We're cutting his mic. Cut his mic. Cut his mic. No, we're not doing that here. That's for gold if you want to know what the hell that was about. But it is time for the big question. We decided it's time for the big question. Match. Of course, the Cruiserweight Classic. Before we get into it, and there's spoilers floating around and we're hearing stuff, let's take a look at the Cruiserweight Classic. And the big question for this week, who do you think is going to win the tournament for the Cruiserweight Classic? And I think it's been really interesting. I know Triple H, I think, tweeted out today we launched the new brand. So it kind of gives a look at how they're kind of perceiving this project that's going to be out of WWE Network in just a couple of weeks. So is anybody, I think you guys were already saying some of yours on break, but Eamon, who do you think is going to win the Cruiserweight Classic?
Who do I think is going to win? I think, well, okay, I'll go with who I think is going to win. I think it's a name that we were coming up with a lot on the break. And for me, that would be Zack Sabre Jr. He's the one who I think with the most kind of buzz, I think, coming out from this for obvious reasons. I think he has the most potential. I'm very excited to see his journey in this tournament.
Awesome, awesome. What about you, Hooven?
You know, I see people on there that kind of have a spot with NXT, like Gargano and Tommaso. So I don't think they'll win it, but I think that's because they kind of have their spot with NXT. Both of which are great. I would actually say I think everybody's picking Zack Sabre Jr., and rightfully so. I think he's going to do it. But I want to go with the underdog here. Somebody, I'm going to say that I'm going to be picking, take a look here. Oh, Brian Kendrick's in it. Wow. I want to say Cedric Alexander. I'm going to say Cedric Alexander or Tony. No, Cedric Alexander. I just think Tony Nese is just like his body's so good. Have you seen? He wrestled AJ Styles at Superstars, man. He's incredibly, incredibly in shape. But I'll take Cedric Alexander. I think he's going to win it.
You know, and I think going down the list, and initially I want to pick like a Johnny Gargano or somebody, like maybe they'll have somebody, you know, it'll prop up somebody that we've already seen for a little bit, mm-hmm. like that. That's my first instinct. But seeing that Nese is on here, being reminded that Nese is on this list. And Nese was great, awesome in the ring, a super cool guy when he was around in IWC here. But I think it's going to be somebody out of nowhere as far as that list goes. At least, like, I mean, there's about four people that are former WWE guys or current NXT guys and stuff like that, right? So we have a lot of variety there. I'm going to go with Nese. Again, let's also disclose, I don't know about 80% of this roster. Like, Eamon hasn't told me about them yet. Bobby, what's yours?
Since Eamon took my other one, I'm going to go with my other choice that I think is going to be in the finals. I'm going to go with Kota Ibushi. I think him and Sabre are going to end up in the finals, I hope. I'm going to pick Ibushi to go over
cool.
top.
Cool.
You know, in Japan, we treat white wrestlers the way you guys treat Asian wrestlers. We get very excited when we see one, hence why we loved Albert.
I thought you were Korean. No?
Don't worry about that. I'm just saying from an Asian perspective.
Don't worry about that.
Okay. Riz, what's your pick?
I'm glad I get to follow that. I'm actually going to go with Noam Dar. Did I say that right?
Can you explain who this is for the rest of us? For the rest of the class?
No. Nobody picked the Mac.
No, nobody picked the Mac.
Robbie
nobody
Mac's
picked the guy with the eraser head.
Or Daivari's brother.
Nobody picked Zumbi because apparently he didn't make weight. Or Zumbi.
What?
Yeah, Zumbi didn't make
weight. But no, Noam Dar is, I believe he does like the same, like the same feds as Zack Sabre Jr. and like all the other guys, but. I just think, like you said, Sorg, it's somebody that's out of nowhere, like somebody that's good, but it's overshadowed by the Zack Sabre Juniors, by the Cedric Alexanders, by the NXT guys, by the WWE guys that are there. But I think Noam Dar is sliding a little bit under the radar that he is going to jump up and take this thing.
All right, can I play an extra game here?
No.
Can I play an extra game? Can I play?
Yeah.
Help me with who these people are. TJ Perkins. Is that also Manic?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. Also, Fabian Aichner.
He's from France.
Okay. Am I the only one that thinks he looks like a Saiyan in his picture on here? Is that weird?
Oh, I can't reach my Dragon Ball.
I can't read. I mean. Like
Anthony Bennett's can play look might take it.
His hair has shades.
That one guy
he has shades, and his hair has shades.
That one guy can split himself.
Really?
In half.
We're going to be exposed to a lot of new people. The influx. You thought the influx of talent in NXT was crazy. This is a big audition for maybe the next round of NXT.
Giant Metal is going to win it.
Giant Metal is a guy.
Yeah.
Giant Metal.
Jeez. Well, it's Grand Metallic. Well, the former Masquerade Dorada has a chance. Yeah, I think he has a chance.
Not Masquerade Sagrada.
No, different person.
He's a cruiserweight, though.
Another very underrated one, I think, has a chance. Like, kind of how Riz just mentioned to me, it's kind of under the radar. Akira Tozawa. Yeah. I would love to see him win.
I don't even that know what words you're saying right now. Too. That's I'm looking forward to this.
You keep saying that, Eamon, Bobby, but who are you talking about?
Real quick, before we get to the Mayhem draft, so Eamon, I imagine you checked out the introductions that were online. I had some problems with Facebook, apparently, trying to watch that video. Like Daniel Bryan's, of course, part of this, and Mauro is part of it as well, which is exciting. No, Hooven is not a Mauro fan.
Mauro's awesome. I'm not. I don't know what it is. I was excited because, like, oh man, he's a legitimate sports announcer, and I watched him on SmackDown. He just, it's overbearing. Okay. Like
he's kind of. I've noticed that on the pay per view pre shows. He'll say stuff where I'm just like, what the fuck are you talking about?
It's like Mike Adamley without the typos. It's just
I think this environment he may be better, hopefully, but
okay.
I was disappointed. Oh, here comes a big kick. We get it, dude. Chill. I'm actually okay with Michael Cole because he just kind of says what he's supposed to say.
It's a different style. I like
there's something wrong with me. I'm like the worst wrestling fan ever.
All right, let's get into it.
Earlier you said you like the Dave Matthews Band and Ryback.
I appreciate their music. I mean, come on. Some of their stuff's good. It's chill. It's like John Mayer. It never hurts to have a little bit, a little bit on.
And again, John Mayer.
Eamon, please set us up. Wow. It is time for the Mayhem Draft. Jeez, yeah, the commercials have been running this week, so I'm all messed up. So what's going on in round four of the draft?
Well, this is our final week of drafting for our teams. We'll get to another wrinkle in this thing later. But we are still drafting teams, each going down the line, picking a wrestler that's available on the WWE roster to draft for our respective shows. Sorg obviously heads up Team Raw with Riz, Alex Cars, Wheels, Dieters, and now a special is this a ringer, I guess you could say, Sorg?
Ringer, yeah. Katie has been very busy. She couldn't get in here for round four. She's actually right now working at a Dolly Parton show.
Wow,
that's the thing that's happening right now. She's working at a Dolly Parton show. Let that sink in. And for you kids out there, go Google Dolly Parton.
Yeah.
Hooven's here. Hooven's going to be a Dutters tonight.
Just very shorter and less attractive. And probably less intelligent.
All around. Yeah. All around.
Pretty much half the version of her. About
half a Dutters is Hooven.
There's your math lesson for today.
Math lesson for today. So he's going to help pick. Also, he does not have, not all the lists, and he does not have access to our planning in Slack. So I'm really interested to see who we get as his picks.
I love Slack. So we talked about Slack months ago. My job relies on it. It's a great tool.
It's amazing. Well, that's for the other podcast, but thank you. but anyways, so that's how we're going to roll tonight. And I think I want to be the other picker since I haven't done it for a few weeks.
And me and Bobby are going to pick first.
Alrighty. So who goes first?
Raw goes first this week. Raw goes first.
All right.
I say Hooven gets the first pick.
Hooven gets the first pick. All right. Hardcore, hard ass Hooven. Who do we pick for Raw?
Yeah, I really want to say Ryback, but he's going to be released here in a month.
Right.
I was actually disturbed that Nia Jax was drafted before this young lady in NXT, who I think is going to be a big star. Alexa Bliss.
Honestly, someone who we were thinking of drafting first.
I was amazed that she hasn't been drafted, good job. To be honest. That was a good pick.
Have you seen the ass on her? My God.
I've seen her. I've met her in person.
Oh, yeah, you did.
Back at the Arnold, and I want to put her in my pocket.
How does Missy feel about this?
It sounds cute when I say it that way.
Why? You think I'd pick her because she's Asian? Asana? Is it Asana or Ascana?
Oksana.
You know, maybe one day the WWE will need somebody that's Asian and speaks English, because all their promos, they just like, I'm coming, get you. Like, they might meet me with someday. Maybe I'll go down to Performance Center and be a manager for the Asian superstars.
You there you go. Like a Sonny Ono?
Yeah, then I'll sue them for racial discrimination and collect the shit.
Because they called you Sonny Ono.
But yeah, Alexa Bliss. Alexa Bliss.
I like it. Okay. I like Alexa it. She's Bliss awesome. All right.
Bobby, you think we should go with the other one people were suggesting?
And I just typed the message.
Okay.
Please so send it to me.
I guess we got it. I guess we know who we're going with. Yeah, our 31.
Can I do it?
Yeah, go ahead.
We're going with Titus O'Neil.
Wow, I can't believe we didn't pick anybody with that one yet.
Yeah.
During the third round, we were all going, like, maybe this time we should pick Titus O'Neil. No, it's okay.
Do you guys know why he does the, do you guys know why he does that? It's a
college, right?
Omega, isn't it?
No. Yeah, fraternity. It's a fraternity call.
Seems right. Seems right.
I like Titus. So, I just wish he didn't push around old people like Vince McMahon.
All right, so I guess it's my pick, and I really, this person's not picked yet? I'm surprised that nobody went this way. Really? He's not picked yet?
No, I don't think he's picked.
I'm excited.
All right, well, let me know if this is wrong, but we're going to go with Xavier Woods. No, he is taken. He is taken.
We picked him.
I completely meant Goldust.
Hillbilly.
The Ageless Worker, man. That's a good pick.
Wait.
That's a good pick. He's what, like 50? Okay, he's working better than he was 10
Goldust
years ago.
Goldust is a good influence on the locker room and very entertaining.
Okay, I like Goldust. Yeah,
yeah. Oh, yo, too bad. We got him. Bobby?
Okay.
Or
Damon's next because I took the pick from him.
Okay, I think we're in a pretty much consensus.
Yeah, we got it.
Okay.
We're going to take a female wrestler.
Uh-oh.
Who also has a good amount of potential and is showing it right now on the main roster.
Don't even say Dana.
What?
Oh, go ahead.
our pick is going to be Dana Brooke.
Ooh.
Playtime has just started.
Really? We had a big debate about Dana last night.
You know, I have a question. I like, and this is something that I kind of saw. I like Dana Brooks in NXT. I thought she's awesome, this great heel. I feel like she's being put in a spotlight too soon. I feel like she is on Raw.
I
still think she's trying to make the most of it.
I think she kind of got lost a little bit when Emma went down, though.
Yeah, because her and Emma, man, they were awesome down there.
Yeah.
They were awesome. But it's crazy that Dana Brooks and Alexa Bliss have not been picked until now.
Mm-hmm.
That's a nice pick. That's a good pick.
Good. This is Hooven's pick.
Yep.
Oh, I get another pick. Let me take a look.
You're going to get five of them, so prepare.
Okay. Well, I'm going to say it, even though he's injured right now. I would take Elias Sampson.
You guys already have him.
I think
we already took him.
We have him. We have him.
Oh, God damn it, guys! You know, I it's hard.
Good pick.
That is a good pick. Really, Sheamus?
Yeah, this is the very interesting.
All right. I have an idea. I'm gonna go with another girl because she's fabulous. Carmella.
God damn it!
Are you in our goddamn warroom right now?
Yep.
Somebody invited me to their Slack by accident.
Yep. Honestly, I want to say you took
no, Bobby.
No, you.
What?
I want to say, Hooven, you took two of our five already. So that's awesome.
Last pick.
Thank you.
Jesus.
I like women wrestlers.
There might be a side war room with Hooven right now.
Shut your face, Mike. You're not the boss of me.
Okay, so do you want to... Jesus, okay.
I said the first one. The first one you said.
The first one I said? Yeah, I think there's a couple
I've been pushing for him for a while.
I'm cool with it. Okay, our number is... As we found out last night on Raw, he's hard.
He's the hardest of hard.
He's the hardest of the hard. Bo Dallas.
Okay.
Inspiration.
I dig it.
Sure.
You like that? You like that last one? You like that surprise in there?
I like that.
Because nobody's even considering that, right?
Wait a minute.
The last one.
Don't say anything yet.
Didn't we already pick him? Didn't somebody already pick him?
Probably did.
I feel like, No. Somebody hasn't. I'm going with it.
Somebody has him?
I'm having it. I'm going with it. And let me know if I'm wrong. I don't see him on the list, but let's go with Axelmania, baby.
Oh, I like Axelmania.
Axelmania. Curtis Axel. Nobody's excited about that pick at all, except for me and Hooven.
I'm excited for that pick.
Ryback was underrated.
Nobody's sad.
Ryback was underrated.
Nobody's sad that I took that pick out.
The chains are off.
Wait a second. This girl can't be so nice.
My favorite part is when people in our Slack are behind.
A little late there.
I'll just say that.
Text me, Hooven. Let me know.
I'm cool with that one that Mike just put in. You think, Bobby?
Do we want to make SmackDown great again?
I think we do.
We're going to take Darren Young.
Which means...
We get Bob Backlund.
Even though he has not appeared in the ring.
Yeah, he is a
contract and he's a manager.
Yeah, he's there. He's cool. It's cool.
Okay. Well, we're behind in our Slack.
Yeah.
All right. It's my turn, right?
That's not right. So they're separate.
No, that was the rules. That was the rules. She's not on the other list. So we're just discussing. Lana actually went with Rusev with the pick, right?
Yeah.
So we're figuring that out. Guys, I'm going to go with this one that I've been talking about in the Slack. I know somebody that has been kind of disappeared for a little bit, but I think she brings a lot to the roster. And that is Naomi.
Are you fucking kidding me?
That everybody completely forgot about.
Let's never type a name again.
No, nobody use our Slack. Because our Slack is fucking haunted, apparently.
Haunted?
It was haunted by Sargatron.
Hey, well, guess who set up the Slack?
This is...
I'm sure I could backdoor into your Slack.
First of all, we haven't done this until Hooven got here.
I know.
Hooven, you're
ridiculous.
You're our lucky man.
I can't believe Alexa Bliss wasn't picked, to be honest.
Yeah. Blame SmackDown.
I have a dark.
What are you gonna do?
I have a dark horse stroke. Somebody else I'm surprised has not been picked.
I'm so mad. Man. I'm so mad. You know what? Let's go with Bobby, are you cool with the remaining person that
who I just typed?
Yes, are you cool with that?
Right, yeah, we'll grab him.
Our next pick is Heath Slater. Yeah, that's a solid pick.
That's solid. A one-man I dig that.
Ooh. God damn it. Get ready for some sulfur.
It's Hooven's turn. What magic is going to happen?
The man with the most underrated theme of everybody on the roster, David Otunga.
Ooh.
Wow. We're going to make him wrestle? Wow.
Yes.
I'll count that, yeah.
Had a dream.
I mean, he's technically a commentator now.
No, David. Wait. Is he a commentator? I thought he was a worker still.
He's commentating SmackDown. No, he's commentating SmackDown.
Is he now?
No, not Otunga.
Yeah.
Well, no, doing it. Until, okay, well, let me retract that then. We're not drafting announcers. I'm sorry.
He's not technically on our list.
I was going to say announcers were going to be a different thing. God damn it! I hate our Slack right now.
Well, you know what? I'm going to go with another girl. What about Natty?
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Natty.
Okay. Is she available?
Natty Party.
Natty Neidhart?
Okay.
Is Natalya available?
Okay. Yeah, she's available.
Oh, I was asking. I'm not saying I pick her.
No. Okay. Yeah, she's available.
Okay.
Yeah. His thumb is still on the chess piece.
Yeah. Come on, guys. Let's see. You guys... Jesus Christ.
Oh, my God. Fuck.
Oh. Really? Somebody took Dash Wilder.
Yeah, we got the fucking.
We got both of them.
We got the Revival and American Alpha.
They're going to tag team champions on NXT, man.
How are they even on NXT?
They're fucking great.
I can't tell them apart.
They're
very easy to tell apart.
We're up now, right?
No.
We're not.
Oh, they still haven't made
a
decision yet?
Yeah, you guys gotta give me. You guys gotta.
It's just Hooven right now.
You guys got to give me a sec. I'm sorry. I was a little bit thrown off that David Otunga is not an active wrestler anymore. That's a little bit depressing in many ways.
Somewhat.
Very. Very, very, very. Let's see. Let's take the shining. Let's take the shining stars.
Travel agents.
You know what? I'm going to take somebody. I feel like if the WWE actually got behind and repackaged, they could do something with in his last time there. I'm going to take Jack Swagger.
Ooh.
Oh, okay. Good pick. Former world champion.
And he has the Rage Against the Machine knockoff thing song going. Yeah. Get on your knees. Bow, bow. It's a good song.
Okay. Awesome. Okay.
Okay. Bobby, we're getting outvoted.
Yeah, I guess we should make Mad Mike happy.
Well, not just Mad Mike. It's a lot
you guys are
I
on
know,
here.
I know. All right. Well,
this
time
is your time, guys.
I know SmackDown is the blue brand, but it's time to make SmackDown all red everything.
No!
Oh, she is?
Eva Marie.
I forgot about her.
And
you were really? Because, God damn it. Because there's okay, I'm going to fucking bury my team right now. Their strategy was that Hooven was going to take her.
I think
he
totally forgot about her.
I would have if I had remembered her. I would have if I remembered
Which
her.
Which means
I can. Okay.
I hope our Slack is happy when they hear what just happened.
Yeah.
My last pick and my sentimental pick.
Look,
that completely happened.
Look back.
You know what, Bobby? I'll give you your sentimental pick. How
last pick. Last pick.
Last pick. It's me.
I want to see here.
Riz, I think we need to jump on that one because that's a good hand to have.
That is a good hand.
I can't think of anything else that would be better than grabbing that.
That shocked me when you guys. So go ahead, Sword. It's your
All right. Opinion. Well, since Hooven didn't follow through on that one, I'm going to go with Natalya.
Okay.
Okay. She's actually a good heel.
Yeah,
when she quoted Owen, I was like, "Hell yeah!"
She's just good in general, so yeah, I'm down with that. Down with that.
Okay, let's go with Okay, so we're going with the male one of those two. The male one.
Yeah. How many picks do we have left?
We're on 37, so we got 4 more picks.
Oh, okay, good. Good.
How many picks do we have left?
Our next. I hate Matt so much right now. Our next pick is Zack Ryder.
Woo, woo, woo.
I know, Sword. You wanted a rider. That would have been a good pick. He's the perfect guy to kick off shows.
Yeah, you saw my other pick in there. 38
for Team
Raw.
Yeah.
Oh, that hurts. So
I know who
much.
I want, though.
All right, he's got something in mind.
Oh, wow.
Hooven's got something in mind.
Is it my pick?
Yep.
So you guys, I'm a big believer in Dynasty Fantasy Football. I like to pick somebody that may not be anybody for a few years, but I'm going to take Sara Lee. Tough Enough winner.
All right. I thought you meant the pilot.
Will you allow it?
I'll allow it, yeah.
She's going to make you cookies.
So you'll allow that, but not.
He signed to a contract.
Yeah.
She's hot, and she can work. I take Sara Lee, Tough Enough winner.
Gotta find that graphic.
You know what? I'm going with the one I put in there.
Who's the one you put?
The woman.
I guess so.
Why is that a groan?
She hasn't had a match in forever.
She had one last night.
No, she did not.
You know what? Our 38th draft pick is Summer Rae.
All right.
And Summer Rae is very underrated.
She didn't have a match. She's the person when Summer Rae's. It's like the Seinfeld gecko joke. When SNL starts the gecko joke,
wow.
You know there's something going to happen to interrupt. Summer Rae's out there.
Summer Rae was always good in NXT. And with somebody who works hard, who is does whatever she's told, she's a good. She's somebody that's very underrated.
Yeah, she is. We've
gotten to the point where we're arguing over Summer Rae.
Somebody just end this now.
I'm not even sure who's left.
Ryback.
But
you got 2 more picks.
Ryback. Yes.
Well, for us, I think we're going to round that. We're going to ride that corner, and we're going to get some R-Truth.
R-Truth, your next pick?
Yep.
I like that pick.
Make it happen. Golden Truth.
Because we have an amazing tag team core right now.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I say we go with the one that me and you suggested, Bobby. And I think Matt did as well.
Wait. No, I was countering you. There's a comment in there.
Wait, what?
There's a comment in there.
No, but okay, but the one with the one Matt, me, and you posted. The one that has three words to it.
Go ahead.
What? He's pretty good.
I don't.
You're gonna.
I don't like him.
He's better than, I can see why. He's much better than other stuff that's on the table. Our next pick is No Way Jose. He's much better than some of this other stuff that's on the table.
They like the dancing. They like the dancing.
Can we borrow Austin Aries from you guys?
We have
Austin Aries.
No, they do.
Austin Aries.
We got a lot of people.
No.
We got a lot
no,
of
you cannot.
Okay.
You stick
Raw.
You stick with Summer Rae.
Let me use Eva Marie.
Whatever. Raw, you get a final draft pick. What's your final draft pick?
Oh, we have one more, too. Right?
Yeah, we have one more.
Is The Rock available, or is he taken?
The Rock?
Yeah.
Are we allowed to book The Rock?
He's on the roster.
Allow it.
He did have a match at WrestleMania.
Allow it.
This is accurate. That's he could pop up at SummerSlam.
What do you think?
Eamon? Is Eamon sleeping? Eamon!
What?
Is it allowed?
What's allowed?
Is it allowed?
The Rock.
I don't think The Rock's allowed.
What?
He's on the active roster.
Fine. Stephen Amell.
No. Stephen Amell.
Stephen Amell counts, yeah.
That was a big thing.
I wouldn't count. No, I said that sarcastically.
Okay.
So is The Rock count or do we need somebody else? I have somebody else that The Rock doesn't count.
I say The Rock doesn't count.
But I think you should go with your gut.
He is on the roster page, though. What's your gut pick?
If I can't have The Rock?
Yeah.
Liv Morgan.
Not on the list.
No, she's on the list.
Is she now? Okay.
She's on the roster.
Liv Morgan. There you go.
Have you seen her?
Yeah, I've seen her.
Ooh. Then I could take the other one.
Yeah, if that's your final draft pick, you know what? Bobby, I don't care what our warming says, Bobby, you get your wish.
I think, and since we took Eva Marie to please Mike here, I think our next pick is also going to be in that vein. We're going to take Billy Kay. Oh, just wait.
She's going to be
the future of NXT.
Yep.
Okay, Bobby.
I'm telling you.
The Rock should have counted.
Wow. That
would have been the steal of the draft.
Have you seen Billy Kay?
I'm trying to remember which one she is.
I have to scroll back up there.
She's the one without the rose.
She's one of the Australians, too.
One of the Australians.
I'm surprised you didn't pick
Kay.
Liv Morgan, cool. Dude, though. Kay. Have you seen Liv Morgan?
Ooh, she is buff.
Billy Kay.
Well, there you go.
Okay,
that was the
round of 40. Holy shit.
That is 40
that
picks.
Fun.
Round four.
I don't know who's left.
Eamon.
There's still people left.
Oh, no. This is going to be great. I already have picks of who I want to shovel over to you guys.
Shining Stars.
Next week, we're doing something very special.
Mm-hmm.
Because this isn't how our rosters are going to be completed. Our rosters are technically not complete yet.
Yeah.
Because next week, each team will get 5 picks. But the 5 picks that they choose will be for the other team.
What?
And for our upcoming SummerSlam cards that we are drafting based off our rosters, you have to use at least one person from those people that are drafted to you in a pre-show match.
Kickoff.
How many pre-show matches do we get?
SummerSlam kickoff.
We get one or two.
We get those numbers.
I believe we get one.
Yeah, that makes sense. There you
it
go.
It has to just include somebody that's on. You can include somebody that's on your roster that you drafted, but it has to include at least one person that was given to you.
There you go. They're calling Hooven 316 in the chat room.
Hooven just He changed the game.
Hooven changed the game all over the place. I love it. Love it, love it, love it. So, okay. From there, finally, I want to know from you guys, what did you learn in pro wrestling this week?
I learned Hooven's psychic.
Yeah. Is that it? Is that what you got?
Is that it? Really?
That's what everybody learned now.
Unpredictable Bobby.
Come back, man.
Riz.
I gotta think. I learned that apparently Ashley Lynn lied and disrespected her family.
What the fuck?
Destroyed their family. Sorry, not disrespected.
What are you talking about? Bitch. What is this?
What
are you talking about? What is this?
There's a sign. Like, I believe in the beginning of the show on Raw, there was a sign that was like front and center that just said, and I use that for the what the Facebook people learned in wrestling. It just says Ashley Lynn lied and destroyed the family, and there was some history towards that. I found out from another podcast. Apparently, some family members of this one lady went to the show because they know, and this is all Florida, by the way, that they were going to watch the show. So they just stood up there holding that sign the entire night. And it just said to make sure that Ashley Lynn. Bitch knows what she did.
Oh my god, it's on the score. It's on the score. Like, sports outlets are covering this.
Yeah. Yes.
Wow.
I know the guy I follow, Mike Malloy, one of the comedians I follow on Twitter, actually had a conversation with the girl, with like another, like a family member, saying, yeah, they were there. And that's why, like, it was like a family squabble between their dad and the lady that's on there, and their dad died, and the family kind of broke apart and became estranged. And it was one of those things where it just started like snowballing into being on Score and on a lot of other places that normally don't cover like wrestling. And it was just weird.
Ashley Lynn is a wrestling fan's name.
It is. Ashley Lynn is like a wrestling name almost.
Jerry Lynn.
Almost. Sister. Almost. All right. And from the Facebook, Riz, thanks for posting this and getting on
top
of that.
Sword. Thanks for slacking.
Hey, Riz, we'll talk about that afterwards. Tragar says that John Cena has obviously never heard of Shane Douglas. There's only one franchise in wrestling, and Cena ain't it. And Alex Carr's learned that it feels great to be able to watch WWE Network up the mountains without needing a workaround. I learned that I can completely experience and try not to throw my laptop on the floor watching Super Indie from home and editing it. That was pretty fantastic. Go buy it. Hooven. What'd you learn from wrestling this week?
I learned, in a rare moment of me being serious, two things. I'll give you the serious one first. That if you work really hard and you stay true to who you are, you can achieve your dreams. Congratulations, Dean Ambrose, John Moxley, whatever you want to call him, John Good. He is the world champion. He did it his way, started in wrestling, did death matches, got known for crazy promos, wears tank top and a jeans to the ring. He's the world heavyweight champion. That's my happy one. Second one, did you know that I refereed a match last minute?
What?
2 weeks ago, I was a ref for a show because they didn't have anybody else up in Big Run. I ref the match with the Virgil and Franchise in it.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
And I learned
I'm sorry.
I learned.
You had a Virgil, a close Virgil experience.
Oh, no.
We're like blood brothers now.
Ask Chess Flexure about this. So I was there, and I was doing a favor, reffing a match for Billtown Championship Wrestling. They just needed somebody. They needed an extra body. So I said I would do it. I've been around wrestling enough. I know the rules.
Stop inviting me to their shows.
You need to come. And I learned
I'm too busy going to Code Red.
Oh, God. That piece of shit. You know what? They have Annie Ann's outside their door. I can't bash them too much. I learned that if there's a noose near the ring and Virgil sees it, he will hold it up and say, "I'm going to hang a brother," before Chest Flexor says, "Get the noose away from Virgil." I learned that this week. Do not leave nooses around Virgil because he'll try to hang a brother. That's his words, not mine. And this happened. Ask Chest Flexor.
That even scared Chest Flexor.
He looked at me with the most serious tone in his eyes, and we just looked at each other. And I said, "What is going on? I did not sign up for this."
Have you ever refereed a match?
I did two matches because one guy didn't show up, and I was there. And they had a small roster, so they're like, "Well, you ref. You know, you've been around it. You're not doing anything else. You're just hanging out." I'm like, "Yeah, sure." So I reffed one match with Santana Diamonds and Suicide Myers. Really good guy, actually. It was a good match. And then I was asked to do the six-man just because I knew Chest and Lee and all of them, and they would help me out with it. But, yeah, I watched Virgil try to noose a man. That's what I learned in wrestling. Crazy shit happens.
Wow.
From the chat room. Matt Harlan's learned that Hooven 316 says, "Have you seen her?"
Liv Morgan. Sorg, if we get enough,
what's that?
If we get enough shirts, we need to make that a shirt.
Yeah, we should make that on the spreadshirt shoppers.
That's how Johnny Laurinaitis scouted talent. He would look at magazines and go, "Dude, have you seen her? Oh my God!"
Yeah, it explains the Divas in the mid 2000s.
Would you agree with our interpretation of her on the midweek war that she looks like a Buffalo Wild Wings waitress?
I would agree with that, mixed with a little bit of Avril Lavigne, who's my number one crush.
You have the weirdest music taste.
No, I'm just talking about like from a hotness perspective.
He said nothing about her music.
I mean, come on, we all like Skater Boy, but
Chad Kroger.
All right. Also from the chat room, we all learned that Barbarian no sells fan shops, and and Mad Mike's learned that Hooven's favorite wrestler is Dad Ass.
Who's what? Right.
That was Mad Mike.
I got mine now.
Yeah, it's true.
All right, Bobby, what'd you learn?
I forgot Bobby didn't do it yet.
I caught up on Lucha Underground and I learned that Ricochet can talk. It's a miracle. Or Prince Puma.
Bobby.
I'm sorry.
Lucha kayfabe.
don't finish that sentence, Bobby.
I know. And then I also learned that Xavier Woods, I just want to say, this whole feud with the Wyatt family with Xavier is like, if you look at him during the promos and stuff that Bray's doing, he's like slowly walking towards, I love it. He's afraid. It brings legitimacy to the Wyatt family again.
Awesome.
I just love it.
Awesome. All right, guys. Thank you so much. First of all, Bobby F. J. Town, at Bobby F. J. Town on the Twitters, talking about stuff.
Talking about floods
and stuff. And of course, Dan Hooven, at Daniel Hooven, hard ass Hooven. You see him a lot of times ringside at IWC. Shooting the photographies.
He's not that bad.
Shooting the photographies. He's around wrestling a lot. Sometimes he's refereeing.
Not again.
No?
Not after that.
He'll referee your graduation party. No, I'm splitting the two.
Graduation party?
So Hooven's ref experience was like my first RWA experience. I don't ever want to see that again.
It's a story for the kids one day.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And of course, Eamon Payton. Eamon, too, please, the voice of Inspire Pro Wrestling down there in Texas.
Yes, indeed.
You got a show or something to plug?
For like a month and a half, but yeah.
Oh, okay.
August 14th, get tickets now.
Get ready and go buy their stuff on SmartMark Video as well. IWC, Super Indie, also on SmartMark Video.
And also, July 23rd, 7 p.m. Court Time Sports Center, the biggest party of the summer, IWC Wipeout happens. Ray Rowe, Chelsea Green, Robbie E are all in the house. Jimmy DeMarco's taking on Dylan Bostic in a title match versus Ray Lynn's managerial contract. Big League John McChesney, Asylum, and Britt Baker team up to take on the Fraternity with Chelsea Green. It's going to be a good show. It's going to be a really big show. It's actually pretty stacked. So get your tickets now, www.iwcwrestling.com. Follow IWC on the Twitters, as Sorg would say, at IWC Wrestling, and also on Instagram at IWC_wrestling. The photos suck, but the intent is well.
And, of course, the Riz, the E-Riz. Riz plays games on the YouTube.
Yes.
I'm at Sorgatron, WrestlingMayhemShow.com, the Patreon, the subscriptions, and the live.WrestlingMayhemShow. Thank you for our crew going insane during that roundup tonight. Thank you so much. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com. You guys are cool.